This teaching you're about to listen to was preached by Jegede Sunday E and recorded live at God's Family Bible Church, Trinidad. Jegede Sunday E is the General Coordinator of Arabs of Revival Ministries and the School of Discipleship. He is also the Missionary Pastor of GFBC Trinidad under the leadership of Pastor Abolaji Akimbo, the General Overseer of God's Family Bible Church Worldwide, Palm Coast, Florida. Listen and be transformed.
Our Father, we just want to thank you, Lord, for gathering us unto yourself this special day. Our Father, Lord, we have come as your children. We'll open up our hearts and we'll receive your word with humility and faith in our heart, Father. We ask, Lord, that your spirit guide us into all truth, Father. And let your truth be driven into every heart, Lord. And let our lives and our situation, Lord, remain the same. We'll receive your word this morning. Thank you, Father. And let the church of God say a big amen.
Amen.
Glory be to God. All right. Now, if someone meets you on the road, walk up to you in the street, and they say, are you a Christian? Are you a believer? And say, yes, I am. I'm a Christian. I'm a believer. I go to church. In fact, my church is just down the road there, all right? And then the person go further, and I say, okay, now, who is God to you? All right, that's the next question, all right? What readily comes to your mind? If somebody walk up to you and say, who is God to you? Now, what comes to your mind? What comes out of your mouth, all right? I know some of us who have really read our Bible, all right, and really know the names of God. Now, we will say, I know God. My God is what? El Shaddai, Lord God Almighty. You know, that's good. Some will say, I know my God. My God is El Elyon. He's the Most High God. Some of us will say, oh, God, I know my God. My God is what? He's the Lord Jehovah Jireh, the Lord, my provider. Some of us will say, I know God is Jehovah Shalom, the God of my peace. Some will say, I know God is Jehovah Ra, the Lord, my shepherd. Some of us will say, I know God. God is Jehovah Nissi, is the Lord, my banner. Some will say, I know God is the God Jehovah Shekinu, the Lord God, my righteousness. You know, some of us will say, I know my God is God Jehovah Shammah, the Lord that is ever present, all right? So we say, I know God is Jehovah Sabaoth, is the Lord of hosts. And do you know what? That is true of God. Is somebody paying attention? Now, that is true of God. God in the time past, especially in the Old Testament, has revealed himself to people by those names. But do you know something? The greatest revelation of God in the Bible is the revelation of God as our Father. Is somebody paying attention?
Amen.
Now, God is the Almighty, all right? If all that you know about God is that he's Jehovah, the El Shaddai, he's the Almighty God, he's Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Ra, and all that big Hebrew names, all right? And you do not know God as a loving, as a good, caring Father, then your revelation of God is not complete. It's not perfect. Amen. Is somebody paying attention?
Amen.
Now, so you see, God as a Father, just Father. Now, that encompasses all the name of God. In the New Testament, God does not just want us to know that he's the Almighty God. He wants you to know that he's your Father. Is somebody paying attention to me?
Yeah.
And you know, when Jesus Christ came into the world, now that is the revelation of God that Jesus revealed to us. And this morning, I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to begin to pray to God as a child of God. So I'm speaking of what I quickly tag, praying as a son of God, praying as a daughter of God, praying as a child of God. Now look at Jesus. When he came in Luke chapter 11, from verse 1, the disciple of Jesus, they went to him and said, could you please teach us how to pray? Just as John has taught his disciple how to pray. But listen to this, they were not yet ready for the revelation. And Jesus said, okay, you want to know how to pray? This is how to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Do you know something? That they would have been taken aback. I wish I were there. People would have said, what are you talking about? No, nobody dare call God Father then. Alright? You only know him as the El Shaddai, El Elyon, the mighty God. Alright? And Jesus said, this way, if you want to come to the Father, you want to come to God, God does not just want you to come to and say, you are Elyon, El Shaddai. No, he just wants you to call him Father. Is somebody paying attention?
No.
I know, they said, but that is not the way the disciple of John prayed. We hear them when they pray. They start with hell on, hell shall die. Oh, the Lord, the creator of the heaven and the earth. Jesus said, no, mine is different. I come to show you the heart of God as a father. Somebody paying attention?
Yeah.
So if you do not know God as your father, then you have not really known God. It doesn't matter what you know about God. It doesn't matter how big, how mighty, how great you think God is. But if you don't know him and begin to relate with him as your father, then you need to grow up in the revelation of God. So Jesus said, God is father. You know, in the book of John chapter 20, now pay attention to this. You know, redemption, all right, is actually adoption into God's family. It's a blessing, a son. That's what salvation is all about. Salvation is now that God is our father. Is somebody paying attention? And now we are children of God. That is what salvation is. Redemption is adoption into God's family. And you know, when Jesus rose from the dead, and then Mary came around, all right, and Mary wanted to cling to him and hold on to him. Look at what Jesus said to him. He said, Mary, in the book of John, chapter 20 verse 17, he said, do not cling to me, for I'm not ascended to my father. You know, when Jesus was on earth, he was always talking, my father, the only place Jesus calling my Lord and my God is on the cross, alright, when he had become a sinner at the cross, and the father has forsaken him, alright, but whenever Jesus on earth referred to God in heaven, he referred to him as my father. But look at the change now, he had just completed the work of redemption, and he just rose from the dead, and look at what he said, I'm ascending to my father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I'm ascending to who? My father. But listen to this, there is a change now. It's not only Jesus' father. I'm ascending to my father and your father.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Now listen to me, that is redemption. That's what Jesus came to do, to make God now our father. He said, I'm returning to my father and your father, to my God and now your God. That's what I'm saying. He's my father. God is our father. Are you listening to me? Galatians chapter 4, the Bible said Jesus came that we might receive the adoption of son from verse 5. And he said, because you are son, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your heart, crying out, Abba, Father. Now pay attention. Now you see, the Holy Spirit came to live in us, to actually give us a revelation of God as Father.
Yes.
To help us to be able to approach the Father and to speak to God and relate with God without any fear.
Yes.
Somebody paying attention? Without any shame, without any guilt. That any time we can look unto him and say, Daddy, alright?
Yes.
Now pay attention to what I'm talking about. You see, there are many of us, alright? There are many Christians that don't relate with God as their Father at all.
Yes.
Do you know, now, the Jewish people, especially the religious leaders of those days, do you know one of the reasons why they hated Jesus so much? You know, one of the reasons why they persecuted him, do you know why? It's because Jesus called God his father. Now, let me show you this in the scripture. Now, John chapter 5, from verse 16. Now, he said, for this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus. Why? And they sought to kill him. Now, he had just healed a man that was by the pool of Bethesda for 38 years, all right? But that was not the only reason. And he did it on the Sabbath. And they don't like that. Now, because he had done this thing on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, my father, you see, has been working until now. I've been working. And therefore, look at verse 18 now. Therefore, the Jews sought all the more to kill him. Now listen to their reason. Because he not only broke the Sabbath, but he did what? But also said that God was his father, thereby making himself equal with God. Now can you see something? Alright? They can't stand it that Jesus called God his father. Do you know why? Because under the old covenant, you dare not call God your father. Alright? It's strange. You can't do that. Why will you? Because when you say God is your father, do you know what you are saying? I have every right to God has. That's what you are saying. I'm a partaker of God. I'm a heir of God. Everything he has belongs to me. And they can't just stand that. Do you know what? These day religious people, they can still call God your father. And if you call yourself a Christian and you cannot relate with God as a father, do you know your problem? It simply means you don't have a New Testament revelation of Jesus. Revelation of God. That is the purpose of the Holy Spirit, to reveal the Father to all, to reveal the love of the Father to all, to make us understand that God, though the Creator, though the Almighty God, is actually your Father. Is somebody listening to me? And so, you know what? Now, you can imagine my daughter walk up into my office and the one will call me and say, Pastor, you know how we say, what is wrong with you, dear? I'm your daddy. Is somebody paying attention?
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm talking about? And that's the way God wants us to come. You know, now it doesn't matter what your daddy is. Maybe your father is a prime minister, all right? And people don't just walk up to the prime minister office. They have to book an appointment ahead of the time. Is that right? And then there are a lot of protocols to observe. There are a lot of security checks and all that. But do you know something? When the son or the daughter of the prime minister is coming, all protocols are set aside. Is somebody paying attention to me?
Yes.
But many of us, we still observe a lot of protocols to approach God. What is the matter with you? He's your Father. He's your Father. Many of us still trying to impress Him. No, you don't need to do that. He's your Father. He's your Father.
Amen.
The son, the daughter of a prime minister, just walking. I said, is that in the office? Oh, yes, yes. Oh, but daddy, this one said, don't worry about that. Don't worry. It's my daddy. All right? He may be your prime minister, but he's what? He's my daddy. That's exactly what God wants us to have. And do you know something? Somebody said this. If you want to know a man's revelation of God, listen to his prayers. If I want to know how much of God revelation you have, all right, how well, how deep you know God, all I need to do is just to stand by your side when you pray. Somebody paying attention? All right. When you listen to the conversation between a dad and his son or a dad and his daughter, then you can actually determine the level of their closeness and relationship. Is that right?
Yeah.
Now, the same way, prayer is a communication, a conversation with God. Now, the way you speak with God, all right, the way you pray to God, actually reveal your depth of knowledge and revelation of God. So, if you only know God as the Almighty, all right, as the great God, the creator of the heaven and the earth, the way you will pray to Him, the way you relate with Him, is different from me that know Him as my daddy. Somebody pay attention?
Yes.
And this morning, I want to challenge you to begin to pray to God as your Father, because He is your Father. Now listen to this. As many of all, John chapter 1 verse 12, as many of all that have received Jesus, that have confessed Him as our Lord and Savior, we have now received a right to become a child of God. Alright? And if you have not done that, you're going to do that today. You understand what I'm talking about? But it takes, now pay attention to this, I don't want you to miss it. God being your Father is not something you work for. Is somebody paying attention? How many of us work so hard for somebody to be your Father? Can you do anything? No, it's just a gift. God just gave you a Father, all right? Even if you don't look like your Father, it's too late, all right? You have no choice in the matter. Is somebody paying attention? All right? But you know something. The same way God being your Father is a gift of God. You don't have to work for Him. You don't have to beg God to be your Father. You don't have to fast for God to be your Father. You know something? You don't have to give any offering or tithe for God to be your Father. You don't have to impress Him. You don't have to do any good works. Do you know all that it says? Is to believe in Christ Jesus and confess Him as the Lord and Savior. As many as receive Him, to them He gave the right. That is the word exousia. It gave them the power. He gave them the liberty, the freedom to call God their Father. Let somebody say, I believe in Christ. God is my Father. Galatians 3:26 says, for you are all sons of God. How? Through faith. To faith in Christ. That's how you become a child of God. So being a child of God is a gift of God. Is somebody paying attention? Now that is important to understand. Alright? Now 1 John chapter 3. He said, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called what? The children of God. I love that. He said, behold, what manner of love. So God being my Father is what? Love of God being demonstrated towards me.
Yes.
Somebody paying attention?
Yes.
So God is not my Father because I love God. Are you with me? No, that's not. Oh, I love God, so it's my Father. No, that's not. He said it was God bestowing His love on you.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying. God loved me.
He's my Father.
So you see, now, God being your Father is a love of God bestowed on you. It's a gift. When something is bestowed on you, it's like a privilege. It's like a gift. It's not a reward. Is somebody paying attention? So now, God being our Father is a gift of love that God bestowed on us. And I love verse 2. Now, move on to verse 2 now. This is beautiful. It said, beloved, now we are what? Children of God. Let's all say now.
Now.
I want to hear you say now.
Now.
I'm a child of God. Now, listen to this. Now, it is not later. The moment you put your faith in Christ and confess Him as the Lord and Savior, you are what? A child of God. But Pastor, I don't look that. All right? Oh, Pastor, I don't even act like that. Do you put your faith in Christ? You are a child of God. Now, that John said, beloved, now that you still have your struggle, is somebody paying attention? Now that you are still failing and falling, not when you get to heaven and you are perfect. Now, in your state, maybe you are here and say, Pastor, you don't know what you are talking about. Now, I've given my life to Christ. I confess Him as my Lord and Savior, but I had a lot of shortcomings, wrong decision. I failed, I've fallen, and all that. The Bible said, now,
amen.
You are still a child of God. Is somebody happy with that? All right. That being a child of God is not dependent on your integrity. That's what he's talking about. It's not dependent on your performance. It's not that you're not making mistakes. No, in spite of your mistake, if your faith is in Christ, you are what? A child of God. God remains my Father regardless of my failure. Is somebody paying attention? I've not been a good father. I've been failing my responsibility. That's not good. You need to work hard. But listen today, if you are truly believing Christ, God is in your Father.
Amen.
Do you know what I'm talking about? All right. Now, don't let the devil cheat you of that. Devil tell you where. God used to be your Father, but now he's no longer your Father because I've not been living right. No, that's a lie. All right. Now you are a child of God in this body, in this flesh, in this our weaknesses. Are you with me? In spite of all our failure and struggle, if our faith is in Christ Jesus, we are a child of God.
Amen.
You are a child of God. I'm a child of God. We are all children of God. But then, how do we now relate with God in prayer? All right? I'm just going to show you one example and then we'll close. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, I told you that I will know the level of closeness and relationship between you and your Father when I'm listening to your conversation. Somebody paying attention?
Yeah.
The same way also, now, the way we relate with God in prayer, now, speak volumes about our revelation knowledge of God, about our depth of understanding of who God is, all right? So, how should a child of God pray? Now, don't miss it. This is where I'm coming to. How should I pray as a child of God, as someone that knows that God is my Father? How does God want me to pray? How does God want me to relate with Him in prayer? All right, now God wants us to pray to Him, all right, relate with Him in prayer the same way Jesus Christ pray to Him and related with Him. Somebody paying attention? So Jesus is our example. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is our perfect model, example, and standard in everything. Alright? The Bible call Him in Romans 8:29, for whom He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be firstborn. Let's not say firstborn. Alright? We are all adopted as sons in the God's family. Alright? But Jesus Christ is what? The firstborn. Is somebody paying attention? Alright? Okay. Now, so the firstborn is our standard, is our example. So what we're going to do very briefly, I won't take your time, is for us to see how Jesus, we're going to pick a classical example in the Bible. I want you to learn how Jesus prayed to His Father as the firstborn, all right? And that exactly is the way the Father wanted to be prayed. Many of us have been praying to the Father the wrong way. And the Father keeps saying, what is wrong with you? When are you going to wake up? I am your Father. Why are you just talking to me as if I'm just someone out there that you have no relationship with? Somebody paying attention? So let's learn how did Jesus pray to His Father while He was on earth. All right. John chapter 11. The book of John 11, from verse 39, all right? Let me just give you the background of this event now, to save time. All right, listen to this. Now, in John chapter 11 from verse 1, we realize that there was a guy called Lazarus, all right? Now, he was in Bethany, and then he had two sisters, Martha and Mary. And one day, Lazarus became sick, all right? Pay attention. And he was really sick unto death. And his sister then sent to Jesus, said, Jesus, Lazarus, our brother, whom you love, is sick. All right? And Jesus in verse 4 said to them, the sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Father may be glorified through the Son. But Jesus waited where he was for 2 more days. And by the time he traveled from where he was to Bethany, it was another 2 days' journey. So Lazarus was already dead in the tomb for 4 days. All right? And you know, when a dead man, someone is dead for 4 days, what do you think will be happening? It's already rotting, decomposing. As a matter of fact, when Jesus came, that is why you see from the start tonight. So when Jesus showed up, all right, he wouldn't knew that he was really the Son of the Father. Somebody paid attention? So when he showed up, look at what he said. He told Martha, take away the stone. And Martha, the brother of Lazarus, said, oh, no, no, Jesus, let's forget about it. You just came too late, all right? And he said, look, Lord, by this time it stinks, all right? By this time it stinks. If we just roll away this stone, nobody is going to stand here, all right? And look at what Jesus said. I love this. Now, look at what Jesus said in verse 40. Jesus said to her, did I not say to you that if you will believe, you will do well? See the glory of Father. Now, don't forget who is talking. This is Jesus, our firstborn. Who is talking? Jesus, who knows that God, the Almighty, is his Father. Now listen to this. Now when you truly know that God is your Father, I mean the Almighty God, the one with whom there is nothing hard, not difficult. Do you know with you there will be no case written on, all right? When people say, let's forget about it, it's just too late. You say, no, you don't know my Father. I know my Father. There is nothing too late. There is nothing too hard for him. That's exactly, you know, many of us, the reason why I say, the doctor says it is incurable and we just have to manage it until like that. It is because you don't know God as your Father. When you know God as your Father, you know that with him, there is no incurable sickness or disease. His power can heal and cure all sicknesses. That's why you need to know God as your Father. People say, oh, it is over, don't worry. No, I know God as my Father, and there is nothing that he cannot do. There is nothing that he cannot change. That is exactly what Jesus was talking about. Now pay attention to me. I want you to see Jesus' mindset. We're going to go beyond the words of prayer of Jesus. We're going to see into his mind, and we're going to see his mental attitude towards the Father and towards the situation. So now look at Jesus, because he knew he was the Son of God. He knew that God the Almighty was his Father. He said, when he said the case is over, he said, no case is over, alright? Come on, take away the stone. And look at when he began to pray. Now pay attention to this now. From verse 41. Is somebody still following me? Alright. Now, John 11 from verse 41. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying. Now, pay attention. And what did Jesus do? Jesus lifted up his eyes and said. Now, this is where we are going. Don't miss it now. I want to look at how Jesus pray, alright, as a standard of how we also should pray to our Father. Is somebody paying attention? Alright, and what we want to see is Jesus' mindset. What are the things that he knew? Why did he pray the way he prayed? Alright, we're going to see his mind position and his attitude towards the Father. And please don't let me lose you. Pay attention now, alright? So when they took away the stone, Jesus lifted his eyes and said this. Now listen to what he said. Father, all right? He didn't say, oh, Jehovah, El Shaddai, where are you? No, he didn't say that. He didn't say, the creator of the heaven and earth, show your faith. No, he didn't say that. He didn't say, Eli, Eli, on the Most High. In fact, he didn't say, Jehovah Shammah. No, he didn't say that. He just said, Father. Amen. Now, so you don't need to know all those names of God in Hebrew, all right? Just know him as your Father. That's good enough. That's what I'm saying, that's good enough. As a matter of fact, that's what the Father wants. Just come to him and say, Father. So you see, Jesus now just say, Father. And look at this. He said, I thank you that you have what? Heard me. So that means before now, Jesus had prayed. But he didn't stop there. Now, I'm going somewhere. Don't get lost. And he said, verse 42 now, and I know that you always do what? Oh, it's only one person in church. You always do what? Sometimes? Sometimes? When I'm good? No, he said, you always hear me. Now, that's the first thing I want you to see. The mindset of Jesus. So, we are looking at the Son mindset as it relates to praying to the Father. Is somebody paying attention? Just 3 things I'm going to point out and then we'll go and eat our lunch. All right? Praise God. So, you see, the first thing I want you to see in Jesus is that he prayed with a consciousness, with a confidence that the Father always hears him.
Amen.
All right? Always, always. Now that's the first thing that I want you to understand. And that's what I want you to have in your mind. That you are a son of God. You are a child of God. If you have truly believed and confessed Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And it doesn't matter where you pray, the Father hears you. Is somebody paying attention? It doesn't matter whether you are alone, in the home, and in any situation, the Father hears you always. He hears always. No, so the Father does not only hear prayer in the church. It's somebody, I need to get someone to agree with me. No, when you pray alone, the Father hears. Is somebody paying attention? Does that mean you shouldn't get people to pray? Get people, all right? Well, get right people, okay? All right? But what I'm saying, you, as a child of God, whenever you pray, the Father hears. Now, that's important. Now, the word here, dear, I want you to pay attention to it, is the Greek word that is called akouo. Now, listen to what it means. It means not deaf. It means the Father is never deaf to your prayer. Not only that, it means to attend to. So it's not just that, the Father hears when I pray. He actually attends to you. He attends to what we are saying. So the Father is never too busy to attend to your voice. Is somebody paying attention?
Yeah.
All right. Now he said, it is to consider what is or what has been said. I love this. It is to give ear to. It is to attend to. In fact, it means to give audience. That's what it means. So the Greek word akouo, that is translated here, there, it means to give attention. Let's not say, I have the Father's attention. I want you to know that always, at all times, in your good days, in your bad days, when you are on the floor, are you with me? When you're on the mountain on the hill, you have the Father's attention. Always, always. Always, always. Don't let the devil tell you, look at the mess you have put yourself in. You better don't pray because nobody's listening. No, tell the devil, I'm a child of God. I have the Father's attention. Always.
Always.
On the sick bed, you can't shout, you can't scream. Just whisper something. You have the Father's attention.
You have the Father's attention.
So when you know this, now listen to this. Now praying to your Father become a pleasurable thing. Alright? You don't have to scream, you don't have to shout. Are you with me? Because you have his ears. Always.
Always, always.
That's what I wanted to see in Jesus. So Jesus knew that. He said, thank you, Father, because I know you have heard me and you always hear me.
Always.
And the second thing I wanted to go home with today is that God is your Father and he hears you always. But Pastor, why does he feel that he does not hear me? At times I pray, I weep, I cry, and I can't hear any voice. Now, that does not mean the Father is not doing something. Now, you know, hear means to attend to. The Father is working out something for you. Is somebody paying attention? You just be patient. Don't cast away your confidence. Don't give up. The Father is attending to you. Is somebody paying attention? Now, so that's the first mindset of Jesus. And that's the way the Son of God prayed. That's the way I want you to begin to pray. Praying with a confidence that he hears you always. In fact, look at 1 John chapter 5. I prefer it in basic English. Bible in basic English. 1 John chapter 5, 14 and 15. He said, and we are certain that if we make any request to him, that is to God, which is right in his eyes, he will give ear to all. Verse 15, very beautiful. And if we are certain that he gives ear to all our requests, we are equally certain that what? We will get our request. That's one good thing about God. If he gives ear to you, then you are sure you get answer to your prayer. Now look at what John says. If he gives ear to our request, now you can be sure and certain that you will also get your request. That's what I'm saying. God hears me.
God,
I will get answer. I want to hear you now and say, God hears me.
God,
I will get answer from him. So that's the first thing I wanted to see. The second thing, very quickly. Now, look at Jesus. Let's go back to John 11. We are looking at a classic prayer of Jesus. And we are singing to his mind. We are understanding his mindset as the mindset of the Son. So we see that Jesus prayed knowing fully well that the Father hears always. Alright? And look at the second thing now. Okay, all right, now go to verse 43 now. Verse 43, John 11. Now when he had said this thing, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And verse 44, and he who had died came out, bound hand and foot with grave cloth, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, loose him and let him go. End of discussion. All right? Now, look at that prayer. All right? Very brief, But look at the amazing result. A man that was dead 4 days, already stinking, already decomposing, and Jesus' brief prayer just raised him up. How many of us like that kind of a prayer, all right? You don't have to pray for 1 hour, 3 hours, just a short brief prayer with great and amazing result. Then you need to start praying with the mindset of a son. Somebody paying attention? So let's look at it now. Let's look beyond what Jesus said here. So when Jesus got there, now, by human standard, all right, from human perspective, it is over, all right, because there was already a stain, the body was already rotting and decomposing, all right. But Jesus said, "Don't worry, you'll see the glory of the Father, all right," because he knew that the Father hears him and he will hear him again and again, all right. And when Jesus got there, then the Bible said the second thing is that he cried with a loud voice and said, "Lazarus, come forth." Now, he was not praying to the Father. Is somebody paying attention? He was speaking to the situation. Is somebody paying attention? He was speaking to a man that was dead. Are you following me? Don't miss this. He was not praying to the Father, all right? But he was addressing the situation, all right? But now, how was he so sure that Lazarus will come forth? Now, pay attention. Now, because he knew that he was the Son of God. Now, pay attention. And he knew that his Father has life and give life. Pay attention. So, Jesus knew that if his Father has life in himself and he can give life, all right, then he has it as well. Somebody paying attention? Do you know what? Because whatever the Father has belongs to the Son. So, Jesus prayed with a mindset that he's the heir of his Father. Whatever his Father has, the inheritance of his Father, everything you see in the Father is in the Son. Somebody paying attention? Are you with me? So, at times when my wife said, "Look at my boy, he's just acting like his father," I smile, all right? That's a commendation to me, all right? Because what is in me is in my soul. The same way with you. Whatever is in God, your Father, is in you. Is somebody paying attention? Yeah. So, amen. Jesus prayed with that understanding. So, he was not begging God to do something about the situation. He spoke because he knew he already had what the Father has in him. Now, look at this. Look at what it says in John chapter 5, yeah, all right? The book of John. Chapter 5, verse 21. Now, let me read 26 and then I'll come back to 21. He said, "For as the Father has life," this is Jesus speaking, "as the Father has what? Life in himself, so he has granted," not that he will give. He said, "he has granted the Son to have life in himself." So, you see, Jesus knew something, that whatever the Father has, he has given him to it. Not that he will give it. He said, "he has granted." Let's not say granted. Granted. You see, most of the time when we come to church, now, pay attention, when we come to church, and that is why we are vulnerable to deception. We think that we are just coming, God has never done anything, he has never given anything, and when we come to God and then we pray, and then we give, and then we do all they ask us to do, then God give us something. No, that's not true. Is somebody paying attention? Alright, the Father has granted us all things. Yes. We are his sons. Everything he has now belongs to us. When we come to church, what we truly come to do is to understand what the Father has given to us and how to enjoy it. Is somebody paying attention? Is somebody paying attention? So when somebody says, "Oh, now you need to sow this so that you can get some healing, so that God can heal you," that's somebody that is just defrauding you of your money. Somebody listen to me, because the healing is already given to you as a child of God. Now, I'm taking you somewhere. Pay attention. So Jesus said, the Father has granted the Son to have life. So you see why he could say to the dead man, "Come forth," all right? And he was so sure he will come forth. Do you know why? Because he knew the Father had life and he also had life. Look at verse 21 now. John 5, 21. Please be patient with me. Now, "for as the Father raises the dead," I loved it, "as the Father raises the dead and give life to them, even so the Son give life to whom he will." Do you know what he said? "I have everything the Father has. I can do what the Father can do." And that is why when he was at the tomb of Lazarus, he didn't ask the Father to send angels to do anything. He knew who he was. He knew that he was the Son of his Father, and everything that his Father had belonged to him. The Bible even called Jesus in Hebrews chapter 1, he called it verse 2. The Bible says he's appointed heirs of all things. And listen to this: "as many of us that have truly believed Christ and confessed him as our Lord and Savior, we are now children of God." And do you know what that made us now? Listen to this. Romans chapter 8, quickly, Romans chapter 8. from verse 15 said, you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption. So the Holy Spirit is the spirit of adoption. The moment you became born again, the spirit of Christ came to live in you so that you can have an assurance that you are a child of God and enjoy everything that a child should enjoy, child of God should enjoy. By whom we cry, Abba, Father. Verse 16, the spirit himself bear witness with our spirit that we are what? Children of God. Do we have children of God in the house? Now, this is where I'm going, verse 17 now. And if children, so what does that make us? If children, then we are what? Yes. Yes of God and joint us with Christ. I'm a child of God. I'm what? A heir of God. Everything that the Father has now belongs to me. Now, pay attention. The word here there is the Greek word that is called kleronomos. Now, listen to what it means. Now, you need to get that. That's very beautiful. All right? The Greek word that kleronomos, it means one who receive now is allotted possession by right of sonship. Now listen to this. So now when you say here, it means it's not something you work for, all right? By the right of being a son in a family, what the father has belongs to you. Does somebody listen to me? Now my son does not need to impress him, all right? What I have belongs to him. You understand? Now, so with the father, I said, kleronomos means you receive your allotted portion because of your placement as a son. So because we're a child of God, having put faith in Christ, now God gives to you, now listen to this, what he has, what he has.
Amen.
God shares with you. That's what it, so he said we are heirs of God. Heirs of God means we receive what God has. Now listen to what it means. Let me read to you. It means one who has acquired. I love that. One who has obtained the portion that is allotted to you. That's what kleronomos means. So to be an heir does not mean that you are still waiting for your father to die. You know what I'm talking about? You know, somebody say, well, I'm just waiting. I can't wait for that old man to die, you know, all right? I know I'm the only son. No, that's not true with God, all right? Now, listen to this. What God has, he gives to you. You know why? Because God's not going to die, all right? So, right from the time you are born again, you receive it already. You receive your inheritance. Now, as a matter of fact, the word here also means possessor. That's what it means. So, we are possessor of God. What he has belongs to us. We share names with him. Now, is somebody paying attention? We are now sons in his family. Now, pay attention to this. We have same nature with him. We have the life of God in all. We have his inheritance inside of all. Now, that is the reason why Jesus, when he got there, just said, Lazarus, come forth. He's talking just as the Father would talk. Do you know why? Because he has what the Father has. He said, I have life as the Father has life, and I can give life just as the Father can give life. Now, pay attention. You see, when you understand this, it's going to change the way you pray. All right? Yeah. Many of us will pray like beggars all the time. If somebody listen to me. Oh, Father, you just heard what the doctor says, that this sickness might kill me if nothing happened within some time. Oh, Father, don't let me die. Oh, Father, you know I don't want to die yet. What is wrong with you? That is praying like a beggar. You are not a beggar. That is praying like a slave, like a servant. You are what? A son. As a son, you have a right, right? Everything the Father has belonged to you. What you need to say, Father, look at this doctor's report, but I reject it. I choose your own report. By your stripes, I'm healed. I have your healing power. And I come against this sickness in the name of Jesus. That is how son prays. Is somebody listening to what I'm talking about? You understand? So you don't beg. You don't beg God and say, oh God, see me the way I'm rolling on the floor so that you may have mercy. You know, some people pray just like that. It's just beggarly prayer. Oh Father, have mercy upon me. What are you talking about? Oh Father, just look down from heaven and just touch me and just visit me. What are you talking about? You need to rise up and deal with the situation as the Father will do, because you are a son of the Father. So Jesus didn't get there and begin to run up and down and say, oh Father, where is your face? Show Lazarus mercy. No, Lazarus, come forth. Do you know what? He's talking as one who has life and who can give life. And he said, it is what the Father has that he has granted me. And I'm telling you that we are joint heirs with Christ. What he has, we possess with him. If he can raise the dead, we can raise the dead. If he can heal the sick, we can heal the sick. Don't let anybody deceive you. You are already blessed by the Father. Look at Ephesians chapter 1.
Ephesians 1:3, all right? Now, blessed be the God, the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us. Let's say, bless us.
You know, when you read the Bible, you pay attention to the tenses, all right? Now, it is in past tense, all right? And people will tell you, oh, just give so that God can bless you. No, that's not scripture. He has blessed you. Is somebody paying attention? Oh, I'm waiting for my blessing. That's not the way the Son of God taught. I am blessed by the Father, and that blessing is going to manifest. Is somebody talking to me? That's the way the Son prayed.
That's the way the Son prayed. He said, he has blessed us. He has blessed us. 2 Peter 1:2-3. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Look at verse 3. As his divine power, according to his divine power,
as giving. Let's say giving.
Amen.
All right. You know, most of the time when we pray those beggarly prayers and say, Father, just show me mercy. Oh, Father, just give me some blessing. Father, just heal me. The Father is saying, what are you talking about? It has been given. You understand? You can imagine, I just, without you asking, and then I just give you this mic, and then you come to me, and then you are rolling on the floor, and you are screaming and shouting, say, Pastor, please give me this mic. Then, what do you expect me to do? I've just been looking at you. I've been wondering what is really the matter. The Father has given to us how many things?
All things.
So if you are not enjoying all things, it's not because the Father has not given to us, because his inheritance belongs to us. Everything that the Father, what does he want to do? Now, you don't get sick in heaven. Somebody listen to me. So if you need healing, enjoy it here.
Oh, yeah.
All right? You don't need money in heaven, all right? Because the streets are paved with gold. Yeah. So where do you enjoy it? Here or now? So what will the Father do with the money in heaven? He has given all things.
All things.
All right? So God does not want us to approach him with a beggar mindset and be begging and be pleading as though we don't have anything. No, when you come to the church of God, you come full. Somebody listen to me. And my job as a pastor is to help you discover what God has put inside of you.
Yeah.
Are you with me? Yeah. But not some of us just like somebody to see me and say, oh, you are going home with something special. There's nothing like that. Everything is already inside of you.
Let's not say, I have it already.
Because the Father has given it. Now, so, you know, when I pray from the point of I've got it already, the way I pray is different from someone that is still trying to get it.
Yeah.
Somebody pay attention?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm still trying to get God's love. No, I've got it. He loved me. I'm still trying to get God's mercy. God is already merciful to me. Oh, I'm still trying to get this. Oh, God has already done it. The way we pray will be different. That is what you see in Jesus' prayer. If it were the Pharisees to pray, all right. Their prayer will fill the whole book of John. Because they will first of all start with all the names of God in Hebrew and then begin to tell the Lord why God must show mercy, why Lazarus should not die and all that. But Jesus just spoke, all right? Because he prayed as one that knew that he shared inheritance with his Father. He's the heir of the Father. And that's the way I want you to begin to pray today, all right? And lastly, we close with it. Now, look at another mindset of Jesus. Number one, he prayed as one that knew the Father had him always. He prayed as one that knew that he shares inheritance with his Father. That what his Father has, he also have it, all right? And look at the last thing, all right? Now, that same prayer. So Jesus got there, after he thanked the Father, he said, Lazarus, come forth. Now, pay attention. I told you that was not prayer directed to God. Now, so Jesus was speaking to Lazarus. But listen to this. Now, before the death of Jesus, it is the devil that had the power of death. Is somebody paying attention? So when somebody died, all right, he's under the hold of the devil. Now, so when Jesus spoke like that, Jesus spoke with authority, all right? Now, because he knew that he had authority. And you know what? He used it with boldness and confidence. So when he said, Lazarus, come for, he said, devil, let him go. That's what he's talking about. Yeah. You can't hold him. You can't tie him down. I need him right here. Yeah. Now, so listen to it. And that is the way the Son pray. The Son does not beg the devil. Somebody listen to me. The Son speak with boldness and confidence, exercising the authority that the Father has given to him. I want you to know that as a child of God, you have authority over the devil. And it's not just a little authority. The same authority that the Father has, that is the one you have.
Oh,
is somebody paying attention?
Yes.
That is what it means to be a son of God, is to enjoy same authority with him. So the same way Jesus speaks to demon and the demon trembles and listen and obeying, the same way when any child of God that really knows his status as a son of God, when you speak also, the demon bows and trembles.
Yes.
Do you know why? It's the same authority.
Yes.
Jesus rose up and said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. And you know what? He didn't say, well, I just give you a little part of it. No! He said, behold, now I give unto you all authority, power. Luke chapter 10, verse 19. I give you authority to trample on serpent and scorpion and over all the power of the enemy. Let's not say, I have authority over all the power of the enemy. So when the devil is harassing you, then the way you pray must be different. Alright? Then the way someone that has authority pray is different from someone that does not have authority. Wow. Somebody, oh please, devil, Mr. Devil, you know I didn't touch you, you know I didn't say any bad thing about you. Why are you troubling me? Alright? That's somebody that does not know that he has authority. But someone that said, devil, what are you doing here? Get lost from this place. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke you. That's someone that has authority. And listen to me, that is the way you should pray as a child of God. Enough of being afraid of the devil. And then you are looking for someone to take you to the river to bait you and cast out demon. And you know what they do to you? Somebody was telling me, said, when they take you to the river, it's not just they bait you, they get some brood, some good brood, and then they begin to beat the demon out of you. Why will you let somebody do that to you as a child of God? Somebody paying attention? You have the authority because you are a child of God. I want to close with this. You know, what I'm saying is this. I want you to begin to rise up with the understanding that God is your father and that you are a child of God. And as a child of God, you have the father attention always. Is somebody listening to me?
Amen.
You have his attention always. In your worst day, you have his attention. And you know what? When you call upon him, he answers. He won't condemn you. Alright? He will help you. If you are falling, he will raise you up. If there is sin, he will forgive you. That is your father. That is your father. I want you to know that you have his inheritance. You are a heir of God and a joint heir with Christ. Don't ask God as a beggar. Ask God as one that has right. Alright? I don't expect my daughter to begin to roll on the floor and beg me for food to eat. Alright? If that happens, you know what? I'm going to cast demon out of her immediately. Because I know that can be my daughter. Something is wrong somewhere. No, you don't beg for food. Is somebody listening to me? That's the way God wanted to come. He said, come boldly to the throne of grace. Come with confidence. Because you know, God has given you right as his son. What he has now belongs to you. Yeah. Don't let anybody deceive you to pay for what the Father has already given to you. Somebody pay attention?
Yeah.
No, don't pay for it. It's freely given to you. Enjoy it. Just ask for wisdom how to appropriate what the Father has given to you. And I want you to know that you have the authority, same authority that Jesus the firstborn has, the same authority that the Father has given unto you. And whenever, wherever the devil shows up, you don't need to wait for the pastor. You don't need to bring the devil to the church. Cast out the, in fact, I prefer that. Get rid of the devil before you come to church. Is somebody listening to me? I think that's better, isn't it?
Yes.
Now, use that authority. Deal with that demon. Cast that demon, sir, and then come to the church and share testimony with us. I want you to rise to your feet. I want you to rise to your feet. Let somebody declare, I'm a child of God. Are you sure of that? Say, God is my father. Tell somebody, say, the Almighty God is my father. The creator of the heaven and the earth. That is my father. That is my father. That's my father. The one that spoke and it was done. The Lord that commanded and he stood far. That is your father. That is your father. The God of all flesh, with whom there is nothing hard, not difficult to do. That is your father. And so from today, stop pleading, stop begging in prayer. Ask with confidence, with boldness. Stop praying beggarly prayer. Pray as a son of God. Pray with confidence and boldness. Pray with all certainties that the Father always hear you and give you attention. Pray as one that already shares your inheritance with God. One who is a possessor of everything that Christ has. I want you to pray as one that is completely loved by the Father. Completely loved by the Father. There are many of us that have suffered rejection from our Heavenly Father. Some of us don't even get to know our Father. Some of us are abused by our Heavenly Father. I'm not talking about your Heavenly Father. I'm talking about your Heavenly Father. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you so much. And do you know what? He can deliver you from that rejection. He can heal you of that pain. There are many of us, each time we hear Father's Day, it's a bad memory for us. Now because our Father was never there for us. Now because our Father was was not a good father, a good mother to us. But listen to this, I'm telling you, God is your father, and he's a good father, he's a loving father. Let God love you, open up your heart to receive his love. He loves you completely, and his love for you is steadfast. His love is constant. If there's any pain in your heart, then you know what, this afternoon, the father love can heal it. He can heal it. If there's any frustrations, if there's any anger that you have carried for a long time because you have been abused, you have been maltreated by your father, I want to let you know there is a father in God. And this afternoon, that's what God asked me to tell you, that he's your father. He loves you. He cares about you. He gives his ear to your prayers all the time. He shares with you what he has. You need to take it. You need to take it. And God wanted to begin to approach him just as a son will approach the father that he knows loves him. God loves you. God loves you. And if you are here, you can say with boldness and confidence that God is your father. Now listen to this. That is a gift from God. Behold, what manner of love the father has bestowed. It is God that bestows it. And you know what? He gives that right to those who receive Jesus. And you know what? This afternoon, where you are, do you know what? If you receive Jesus and believe truly that he died for your sin, that it was a sacrifice for your sin, and that God raised him up the third day for justification, and you believe him, now you know what? God will be your father right now. And everything is going to change. Everything is going to change. You are going to have his inheritance. You are going to have his love and his acceptance always. You can do just that just now. And just say, Father, I just receive Jesus. I believe him. I confess him as my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Lord, because you said when I receive him, I also receive a placement as your son. I receive the spirit of adoption. And now you are my father. You are my father. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Just for a moment, I want you to open your mouth and I want you to pray as children truly pray to the Father. I want you to open your mouth and pray as a son, as a daughter. We speak to the Father-in-law. Say, thank you, Father, for loving me. Thank you for accepting me always. Thank you for you always hear me. Oh, thank you, Father, for giving me your inheritance, for giving me authority over the devil, over all the works of the devil. And today, in the name of Jesus, just like Jesus did, is there any Lazarus in your life? Something that seems to be dead? Something that you have lost hope on? Something that people have told you forget about it? Today, you are going to visit it. And just for 1 minute, I just wanted to open your mouth and you're going to say, Lazarus, in my life, come forth. Maybe it is your health. You're going to say, let my health come forth. Let my strength come forth. Yes, my breakthrough come forth. My prosperity come forth. I want you to open your mouth and declare it. I want you to declare it. Yes, call it forth. It is time. It is time. It is time. It is time. My miracle show forth. It is time in the name of Jesus. It is time in the name of Jesus. The devil can't stop me. The devil can't hold it back. You are the one that have authority. You have the authority of Jesus. We're the book of Satan in the name of Jesus. We're destroying all your works in the name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you for being our Father. Thank you because you love us always. Thank you because we are always acceptable to you in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father, for giving to us all that you are. Thank you, Father, for sharing your nature, your life, your authority with us. Thank you for giving us authority over all the powers of the enemies, over all demons, principalities, and power, over all the works of the evil one. And Father, I pray in the name of Jesus for everyone under the sound of my voice that these truths, oh God, become rooted in their mind, Father. That they will not approach you as a beggar anymore. They will not talk with you, pray with you. Lord, pray as a slave, as a servant. But they will pray with boldness and confidence. Lord, as a child, as a son, as a daughter that is truly loved by God. Help us to understand, Lord, that Lord, you have given us all things that pertains to life and godliness. That we will not pray as beggar, always pleading and begging. But Lord, we will appropriate with boldness and with faith that which you have freely given to us. Thank you, Father. I speak for healing, Lord, upon those who are sick in their body right now. I rebuke all forms of health condition right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I command strength and vitality upon the organs that are weak right now. Any organ or system of the body that is weak, I speak strength upon you right now. I command vitality right now. Respiration right now. Linda repos secretary and every bone problem is healed right now. Wherever you have pain, the pain is gone right now. The pain is gone right now. The pain in your body is gone right now. Every form of arthritis is healed in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. We give you glory, we give you praise. Do you receive the word of God this afternoon? If you receive the word of God, shout it loud, amen. Amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah.
We hope you have been challenged, encouraged, and motivated to become more like Christ by today's teaching. If you would like to find out more about Eras of Revival and get additional teachings and materials for your healthy, spiritual growth, visit our website today at www.erasofrevival.org, or if you would like to enroll at our School of Discipleship, visit our website www.theschoolofdiscipleship.org.uk. This teaching was made possible by the prayers and generous free will offering, donation, and gifts from partners like you. You are welcome into partnership with us today. For information on how to become a partner, please call 1-868-292-9270 or 1-866-703-5572, or you can email us at info@erasofrevival.org.uk. Thanks for listening.